Slips, the beer that made Milwaukee famous, presents The Halls of Ivy, starring Mr. and Mrs. Ronald Coleman.
This is Ronald Coleman.
And Benita Coleman.
Inviting you to join us again on the campus of Ivy College as the guests of our sponsors, the brewers of Schlitz beer.
The taste of Schlitz. The taste so many people prefer has made Schlitz beer first in sales in the USA. If you like good beer, do as millions of people are doing all over the nation. Ask for Schlitz, the most popular beer in history. Welcome again to Ivy College, that is, in the town of Ivy, USA. Some people can go out for an evening simply because they want to go out, and with no apologies to anyone. But Dr. William Tomhunter Hall, president of Ivy, who takes his responsibilities and his obligations quite seriously, feels that taking his wife for a drive in the country demands some kind of justification. He tries to expiate his sense of guilt with a little help from Walt Whitman.
And light-hearted, I take to the open road. Healthy, free, except for gasoline at 28 cents a gallon. The world before me, the long brown path before me.
The path that I see is gray, love. Gray with a white stripe.
Thank you, darling. The long gray with a white stripe path before me, leading wherever I choose. Done with indoor complaints, libraries, querulous criticism.
Well, now, you skipped a couple of lines, didn't you? The ones about, henceforth I ask not good fortune, I myself am good fortune.
Oh, yes. Well, why, Vicky, my darling, you astonish and delight me. Is Walt Whitman one of your favorites?
Well, he is now, but I must say I met him accidentally.
How does one meet poets accidentally?
Well, I used to know Paul Whiteman quite well. I liked him very much. I saw a book in the library that said Whiteman on the back of it, and I thought it was his autobiography, only when I got it home, it wasn't Whiteman, it was Whitman. I read it anyway. You've got a middle-of-the-road fella ahead of us, haven't we?
Yes, yes. One of those drivers who thinks that holding the crown of the road makes him king of the highway. Genus Roadhog. Porcus Macadamus. Hard of hearing, soft of brain, and short of physical violence, difficult to persuade.
Oh, that one, he wobbled a bit.
Conditioned reflex. Means nothing. Oh, well, I see no point in making an issue of it, considering that we have no commitment to get any particular place at this particular time.
Well, you can always go Christmas shopping.
Mm-hmm. Oh, look, what about that road to the right there? It looks quite attractive. Shall we take it?
No, what can we lose except friend Porcus? Yeah, I'll bet there wouldn't be half as many accidents if a lot of drivers had better manners. Do you want to buy Emily Post a motorcycle and let her patrol the road?
Splendid idea. It's strange how low-test civility can be accelerated with high-test gasoline. How a foot on the throttle seems to throttle a pleasanter instinct. I think I'll do a monograph on the subject entitled The Internal Combustion Engine. How it takes the gentility out of a gent and the gallantry out of a gal.
A strong chapter on women drivers, I suppose.
No, not necessarily. No, dear, but I have two leading exhibits in my own gallery. I classify them as the stoplight soloists and the intersection dramatists.
Oh, yes, I know. The stoplight soloist is the one who starts honking at you from behind right after the light changes. Yes.
That type is usually a man. But the intersection dramatist is usually a woman. It is the kind who makes a great, big, purple adventure of a left-hand turn. She signals tentatively, if at all, sets her teeth in an animal snarl, makes a wide swing to the right, and then...
What's the matter?
The motor. It's missing a little.
Missing a little what?
A little joie de vivre or something.
Suppose you're going to claim we're out of gas, Casanova. I know you college boys.
Dear girl, such a primitive amatory rules would not have occurred to me. No, I'm above such sophomoric stratagem. My romantic approach would be on a more cerebral plane. Books, flowers, concerts, perfume, compliments, a steady but forceful wearing down of opposition.
Yeah, well, all the opposition you got from me, darling, you could put in your eye.
Well, at least you gave me the illusion of being masterful, for which I'm grateful. Now, let me see. Lights seem to be as bright as usual. Starter full of energy.
Yep.
Ignition is on. We have plenty of fuel.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Obviously some mechanical failure.
Well, anything mechanical beyond winding a clock or turning a doorknob is quite apt to be out of my province. Well, I suppose I should make a modest effort to locate the trouble. Have we a flashlight, my sweet?
Yes, it's here in the glove compartment, I think. Yeah, and let me see. Yes, mask and golf tees. And, oh, there's that black glove I've been looking for. And how on earth did this marble get in here?
Yes, I know. Any flashlight?
No, not yet. But I found your broken sunglasses, and it is... Oh, it's half a bar of chocolate. It's lovely. Time I've ever tasted tin foil wrapped in chocolate.
The flashlight, Vicky.
Yeah, and Toddy, look what I found. An invitation to the opening of Gone with the Wind. Yes, here's the flashlight. Works too, surprise.
Then, darling, I shall now attempt a graceful, or graceful bit of mechanical legerdemain. Vicky, what a lovely night. Come on, come out and sit on the running board.
Yeah, this car doesn't have any running board, you trickster. I'll lean against the fender and criticize. But go ahead, open the lid and take a look. It's probably just a loose tube.
I think it was Carlyle who said, "Man is a tool-using animal. Nowhere do you find him without tools. Without tools, he is nothing. With tools, he is all."
All?
No, all. Oh. Carlyle, it is obvious, didn't realize my infelicity with a screwdriver.
Yeah, well, somebody's coming up the road, Todd, and I don't think it's Carlyle.
I've settled for Mr. Kettering of General Motors. Well, that was just a minor pleasantry to show that my spirits are not drooping.
Yes.
Hello there.
Hi.
You got trouble?
Yes, apparently.
I thought I recognized the car you passed me a while back.
Yeah, you should have found a ride with that pack of books you're carrying. But in the light of what happened, it wouldn't have done you much good.
Oh, I don't mind the walk. I walk home from the Ivy Library all the time.
You walk from Ivy? Why, that's at least 5 miles.
It's near as six. That's not far when you've got the time. I try to make the time. After a few hours study, I need the walk. Say, can I hold the flashlight for you?
Yeah, well, I thank you. That would help you.
You see, I think better when I walk.
Really? I think best in the shower. But it's too wet to make notes, so I always forget what I thought.
Walking these days is generally regarded as an obsolete type of locomotion. I'm happy to hear that you find it useful.
It's a pet theory of mine that men have forgotten how to think because they've forgotten how to walk. Look at the Greeks.
Where?
Where's my screwdriver?
It's in your left hand, yes. Oh. That's the hammer in your right hand.
Look at the peripatetic philosophers. They knew what they were doing. That's why Aristotle used to teach his students while walking in the woods outside of Athens.
Why did it possibly be there?
They don't do that anymore in college. They keep you clamped up in a room, and then they say, study hard and widen your horizon. In a room.
Well, on the other hand, there have been many men who have taken a long walk in the world and never left their own four walls.
The sedentary travelers, the armchair wanderers, the spark plugs look all right.
How are you doing, Willie Woodpecker? Found anything wrong?
The only thing I found wrong is that so far I found everything right. Oh. What about your generator? Did you check your points yet? Points? Oh, yes, points. Now. Points, yes. Now we're getting somewhere.
Yes. Well, what are points? Point me out some points.
They're right in here, man.
Oh.
Well, you sound as if you had some practical experience in these matters.
Well, I guess you could call me a mechanic. My dad owns a garage, and I'm always working on cars myself.
Well, we need a fresh mind on this problem. The trouble may be with your distributor.
Yes, William. You better call him first thing in the morning.
Now, check on the ignition cable and the contact points. Trace the lead lines to the induction coil and the battery, and then check for a vapor lock in the fuel line.
I should do that.
Here, let me help you.
All right, Vicky, try starting the motor.
You would take your hands off everything first, darling. You may be all thumbs here, but let's keep them on your hands for old time's sake.
It's okay, ma'am. Go ahead.
Fine. Fine, Vicky, you can turn it off now.
Well, congratulations. It's a remarkable example of collaboration and a most illuminating half hour on philosophy.
Oh, I'm sorry when I get started on that. I'm off to the races. That's my subject.
I hope the discussion distracted your attention from my mechanical ineptitude.
Well, you did a swell job, sir. You've got to have a feel for that sort of thing.
Well, I don't get much opportunity, but I like to use my hands. Someone once observed that it's a moot point whether the human hand created the human brain or the brain created the hand.
Hey, I like that. Who said it?
I'm pretty sure it was Alfred North Whitehead.
Whitehead?
Well, no wonder. That's my man. That's what I came to Ivy for. Professor Thorndike's a real disciple of Whitehead. I'd say that Professor Thorndike is the best modern philosopher since Whitehead.
He'll be happy to know that someone thinks so. Do you mind if I tell him?
Well, I figured you knew him. I guessed right away that you were a professor at Ivy, sir.
Well, Dr. Hall is a kind of professor without portfolio. A plenipotentiary extrapotentiary.
Now, Vicky, it's extraordinary. And I'm not.
Wrong. Well, you're Ivy's Dr. Hall.
Yeah, Mrs. Hall's Dr. Hall.
Well, I feel pretty silly sounding off about philosophy to you, sir.
On the contrary, Mr.
Kimball. Jeff
Kimball. Well, Mr. Kimball, I think that the greatest pleasure I have at Ivy is that of being a sounding board. So come visit us soon and prepare to let yourself go.
Yes, the next time you feel the urge to walk and you can pry yourself loose from your studies, peripatetic yourself over our way. We'd like to see you again.
Well, thanks. Thanks very much.
Now, let us drive you home.
Well, thanks just the same, Mrs. Hall, but I only have to cut across the field here. I live just over the hill, and it's pretty late, so I'd better be going. Good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night. Ah, Vicky. You know, I'm perpetually being startled and somewhat humbled by the unabashed presumption, brazen conviction, and wonderful faith of the student who is just beginning to think.
I'm just beginning to think, too. We forgot to pay him. And after all, he did help. Well, a little.
A little. He was indispensable. And I shall insist upon implementing our gratitude the first time I see him on the campus.
Well, good. But you know, Toddy, he never actually said, are you sure he is a student of ours?
What makes you think that he isn't?
Nothing. Only what makes you think that he is?
Nothing. But if he isn't, he ought to be. It's a pleasure to meet a young man who doesn't wait to use his brain until his hair matches his gray matter. Lucas, Darling, didn't I write a check for the dentist a month ago?
Oh, yes, Tommy. I mailed it again yesterday.
Well, thank you, dear. I love a girl who does impulsive things. What do you mean, again?
I forgot to tell you about that. It came back from England yesterday. I put it in my last letter to Aunt Edith by mistake. Well, now she's all upset. Dr. Bill, she wrote. I must know she'd be glad to help, she wrote. Why didn't I tell her, she wrote? So now I've got to sit down and write a long explanation.
I should think you would have to, and don't mail it to Dr. Lucas. Here's the answer to our question about Jeff Kimball.
Hmm?
Dear Dr. Hall, my son has written to tell me how happy he is at Ivy and how kind you've been to him. I don't think Jefferson would tell you how hard he has worked to go to Ivy, although his father thinks that it is foolish for him to go so far away to take up his philosophy. I believe in Jefferson, and I know you will too when you get to know him better. Thank you for everything. Very truly yours, Mrs. Anna Kimball. It's postmarked Port Orford, Oregon.
Well, that's very sweet, but it's impossible. How could Jeff's mother know that you were kind to her son when you only met him last night? And it was he who was kind to you. Yet come to think of it, you owe his mother a letter.
Oh, I think young Kimball was simply using me as a figure of speech. Which in my more lucid moments, I sometimes think I am. However, I'm curious about our young friend. Yes, I'll call Professor Thorndike about him right now.
And don't forget to tell Thorndike you have a TL for him.
TL?
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure that he's familiar with that calculating method of soliciting compliments tonight. Professor Thorndike? This is Dr. Hall speaking. Professor, I met a young student from your department last night. He struck me as an outstanding young man. I'd appreciate it if you'd give me your opinion on him and keep me posted on his progress. His name is Jefferson Kimball. Oh? Well, that's odd. From his conversation, I assumed that he was in philosophy. You'll check further, then? Right away? Fine. Thank you very much, Professor. Goodbye. Well, Professor Thorndike has never heard of Jeff Kimball.
Well, I'll bet Professor Thorndike hasn't heard of a whole lot of students who've been in his classes through all 4 years of college. He's wonderful, you know, but he's such a far away man. Every time I meet him, I want to ask him how Socrates is, or if he's been Queen of Sheba lately.
Now, that distracted air of his is very deceptive, Vicky. He's reputed to be by far the best poker player on the faculty. They say he bluffed Professor Benson out of a 2-volume limp leather set of Montaigne with nothing in his hand but a Texas Triumph.
A Texas Triumph?
Yes, darling. The deuce, tray, 7-9, and jack of nothing against the queen high straight.
Oh, thank you. And now what is the 2-volume limp leather set of Montaigne?
And now, please. Hello, Miss Reed. This is Dr. Hall speaking. Would you please look up the registration card for Jefferson Kimball from Port Orford, Oregon? What? Oh, Professor Thorndike has just called you. No Kimball. What, not even a special student? Well. All right, thank you. Thank you. Goodbye.
Finnegan out again, Finnegan.
He was never in. There's no record of him at all. Why didn't I ask him if he were a student at Ivy? But why isn't he? He left Oregon to come here. He wrote his mother that he was here. And he is. But he isn't. Now, why isn't he? And where is he?
He's over the hill.
Over what?
Well, that's what the man said. He said he lived over the hill.
All right, but which hill?
Well, the hill that we saw at the bottom of. Excuse me. I mean, which the bottom of we saw that.
Of which I haven't the slightest identification of. However, he did say that his father owns a garage.
Yeah, which we now know is in Oregon, but he also said that he works on cars all the time.
Which is probably what he's doing now.
So?
Vicky, as it's such a common, if controversial, practice to shop around for promising athletes, I don't think it would be reprehensible in our part if we went out of our way a little to recruit one promising student.
Well, that's right. We could use some brains with our biceps.
You know, oddly enough, biceps is derived from the Latin meaning two-headed.
Now, isn't that wonderful? glad to be able to keep your noses to two grindstones.
Yes. Now, let's get in the car and start looking for a young Aristotle and a Greaser. We'll take a spin for Spinoza.
Hi, Doctor.
Hello there. You have a young man working here named Kimball.
Sam Kimball? No, Dr. Hall. He left and went over to Watertown about 6 months ago.
No. Jefferson Kimball.
Oh, Kimball. No, never heard of him. You might try Pete's. I think they took on a new man.
Oh, well, thank you.
Say, wait a minute, Dr. Hall. Your back tire looks awful low.
Oh? Why, I just had it checked when I got gasoline.
Well, and I'm afraid you got a slow leak. Better leave the tire here. Let me fix it.
Oh, all right. Hey, do you have a mechanic here named Jefferson Kimball?
Kimball? No, nobody here by that name, Dr. Hall.
I see. Thank you.
Say, Dr. Hall.
Yes?
Race your motor, will you?
Why, all right.
I hear that whistle? You got a weak gasket there. If you can spare 20 minutes, I'll fix it for you.
20 minutes?
Kimball? Not here. Say, Dr. Hall, have you looked at your paint job recently?
Well, no, I haven't.
Yeah, it's beginning to flake a little.
What, really?
Yeah, I'm running a special this week, and I don't want to pressure you or anything, but you better not let this go. Better bring it in and let me paint it for you. I'm sorry, Dr. Hall. It'll take me till Saturday to finish the job, but you couldn't drive it out of this garage in the condition it's in anyways. I couldn't guarantee what might happen.
Well, I can guarantee what'll happen. We'll walk home.
Well, there's one comforting thought, Vicky. We will eventually have a completely reconstructed vehicle.
Mm-hmm.
At a cost which I hesitate to estimate. Not being under the influence of affluence.
Yeah. And all on account of Mr. Kimball, who ought to pay ours at the garage. The accounts, that is.
One thing he's done, he's given me an appetite. There's nothing better than the mental stimulation that comes from walking.
Oh, darling, I hope Mr. Kimball is tender, because I think we're going to have him for dinner.
What?
Yeah, look, the hills come to the halls. There he is, sitting right on our front porch.
Yes, come back, Dr. Hall.
Well, hello.
Oh, Mr. Kimball, I'm happy to see you. I know you're busy, Dr. Hall, and I don't want you to think I'm taking advantage of you just because of last night, but you see, I've come a long way.
Yes, Oregon,
and I thought you might... Oregon? Well, did I tell you I was from Oregon?
No, your mother did.
Mother?
Mm-hmm.
She wrote me a letter thanking me for being kind to you.
Well,
I can explain that. No, that isn't necessary, but did you want to see me about something?
Yes, sir. I wondered if you'd speak to Professor Thorndike for me. I'd like to ask his advice on certain matters, and I thought I might even get permission to audit some of his classes.
Oddly enough, I've already spoken to him about you. You see, I assumed that you were a student at Ivy. Oh, I want to be, Dr. Hall, but I can't.
Well, what's the matter? Not enough credit?
Oh, no. I was too late. It rained and I missed the boat. Well, I know it rains a great deal in Oregon, but what does that to do with you not getting into Ivy?
Oh, it didn't rain in Oregon, Dr. Hall. It rained in South Dakota.
It seems a little cloudy here, too. What I mean is I hitchhiked to Ivy, but I was marooned for 5 days in South Dakota and missed the entrance examination.
Well, why didn't you holler for help when you got here?
Because the delay was my own fault. I didn't have any foresight. I should have allowed enough margin to get here in time.
Well, the knowledge of the weather is not a prerequisite at this college.
It's true that we have a closing date for examinations. But occasionally I exercise my dictatorial powers and set back the calendar. Then... You mean I can still get in?
Well, after the grief you got on my husband, he can use a little of it to slide you into school.
Jeff, I sometimes have a terrifying picture of college as a huge machine for grinding out credits and building up muscles. But I'm reassured when someone like you comes along who will take, let us say, elementary astronomy because he wants to know something about the universe and not because it's a snap course worth 2 units. So welcome to Ivy.
I don't know how to thank you, Dr. Hall.
No, then please don't.
No. I believe with Shakespeare that silence is the perfected herald of joy. I were but little happy if I could say how much.
And in your case, Jeff, getting into college really was just a matter of mechanics.
Starring Mr. and Mrs. Ronald Coleman has been presented by Schlitz, the beer that made Milwaukee famous. The taste of Schlitz, the taste so many people prefer, has made Schlitz beer first in sales in the USA. Why don't you, too, enjoy the most popular beer in history? Next time, every time, ask for Schlitz beer. Now, here again are Mr. and Mrs. Ronald Coleman.
Good night, everybody.
Good night from all of us.
And from our sponsor, the Joseph Schlitz Brewing Company of Milwaukee, Wisconsin, and its thousands of friendly dealers throughout the nation. Good night.
Night.
Good night. We'll be seeing you next week at this same time at the Halls of Ivy, starring Mr. and Mrs. Ronald Coleman. Jeff Kimball is played by Victor Perrin. Others in our cast were Paul Friese and Jerry Houser. Tonight's script was written by Barbara and Milton Merlin and Don Quinn. Music composed and conducted by Henry Russell. The Halls of Ivy was created by Don Quinn, directed by Nat Wolf, and presented to the Joseph Schlitz Brewing Company of Milwaukee.